Well, I'll tell you, if you do this much for me, that'll work, because she's like, usually like every, so move the car around and then you do the visitation to the movie. Just do that for me. I would appreciate it. So what are you doing now? Is this what you want? You can't do that. That's your school, Jessica. Mama let her wear it.
And then I think he gave me the sister.
Thanks.
jackpot grandma's cross on my day.
Fair.
Remember this kid who knows the card and she's done it. Yeah, that's one of the games. It's just the humor that is.
Where are all the rooftops? Good afternoon. Welcome to the 410 service for the celebration of life of our dear friend, beloved Sharon Ann Lesser. Sharon, you knew I wasn't going to start this on time, right? Like, you knew something was going to happen, right? I see you smiling, Sharon. I see you smiling. So, music today will all be, most of which will be through the speaker system. There will be a couple songs that, if you know it, we invite you to sing along. But other than that, we're going to do our best to be just like Sharon, short and sweet, but there are some times of memorials and tributes that will be very important. So we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy, and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows, so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Now, when we were baptized into Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were therefore buried with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let us pray. Almighty God, those who die in the Lord still live with you in joy and blessedness. We give you heartfelt thanks for the grace you have bestowed upon your servants, especially Sharon, who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors. May we, with all who have died in the faith, have perfect fulfillment and joy in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So, it's well to sing, and it's good for us to sing. So I invite you to sing with us by Alan Jackson, the Alan Jackson version, Amazing Grace. was beautiful. Just enough twang that I think Sharon would have loved that. So, Sharon's nephew Brandon, unfortunately, could not be here, but definitely is here in spirit, and he has sent forth a tribute for his Aunt Sharon that I'll read to you now. From the days I was knee-high to a grasshopper, Aunt Sharon was always a part of my life. She was no different than any other person I'd met, except in one aspect. Aunt Sharon had the gift of teaching me things about life when she was just being herself. From the late nights, Aunt Sharon and I used to do watching our favorite movies. Matter of fact, I believe the movie Cannonball Run was one of our favorites. Needless to say, I think that's where my need for speed started at. Of course, we can't forget our other classics, such as Police Academy, Short Circuit, and Aunt Sharon's friends, Freddy Krueger and Pinhead from Hellraiser. Nice, Sharon, nice. Yes, Aunt Sharon used to spook me at 7 years old. See, she's not as innocent as y'all think. Trust me, I know. Aunt Sharon was one of, if not my biggest supporters from my t-ball days through high school. She was at every sporting event she could attend. I can't say this about many people, but Aunt Sharon was the true definition of the quote, a diamond in the rough. Because Aunt Sharon shined like a diamond in this thing we call life through good or bad. Aunt Sharon always shined bright. For 38 years, Aunt Sharon was always a part of my life. She used to always call me, oh, Jeffy Poo. And as many of you know, she loved NASCAR and that number 24 of Jeff Gordon. Yeah, we're going to touch on that a few times today. But I never had the heart to tell her my favorite driver was Rusty Wallace, and he was way better. I tell y'all, as I grow older and truly understand her love for Jeff Gordon, I was kind of confused on how Jeff Gordon never put a restraining order against Aunt Sharon. Because everyone knew Aunt Sharon knew more about Jeff Gordon than his own wife. And let's not get started on the Osmonds. Aunt Sharon, as I said, you're a part of my life for 38 years, and now you'll be part of my heart for eternity. This is not goodbye, but until we meet again, I'll continue to live life by those positive vibes you instilled in me over the years. I love you and miss you. I'll see you again someday. Love, Brandon. And now I'd like to invite my mom, Marianne Amlott, to come forward. Oh, you weren't ready, Mom?
Well, I just have to turn on my phone. Oh.
My mom was a lived with Sharon for how long, Mom?
16 years.
16 years.
Maybe a little short of 16.
And was hired to be caretaker, but they became best friends in that process, and thankfully brought us into Sharon's life through that. And they got in some trouble along the way too.
Well, we're not going to talk about that. Because I don't remember. Just give me a second.
You being on the phone does remind me of mishaps. Mom always kept her phone on her in case Sharon called. And we were in the middle of prayers during church, and everybody was quiet, and the phone's ringing. I'm thinking, oh, who is on that phone? Like, whose phone is ringing? Come on, turn it off, turn it off, turn it off. And then I hear my mom pick it up. Hello? So I got on there a little bit. She said, well, it could have been Sharon. Call if she needed something. You know what? Why don't you get yourself together? And I'll invite Sharon's sister-in-law, Laura Lee, to come forward, and her friend Harriet, who will be her assistant today. Laura Lee has written some things down.
My name is Harriet Sturm, and Laura Lee, our Together we are sisters from different parents. This is Remembering Sharon, written by Laura Lee. I am just giving a voice to it.
She's making me stand up here. That's why I asked her to write it, so I won't have to be up, or read it, so I won't have to look her.
Right. Remembering Sharon. When I started dating Jeff 17 and a half years ago, I would never have thought I would be gaining a new friend, sister. We became friends very quickly and it was easy to like her. Who wouldn't? She had so much joy to give to everyone around her. But she could be a fireball if she wanted to be. I always laughed when she gave Jeff hell. Sharon don't take any bull from her brother Jeff, but the bond between the two of them was amazing. We have so many awesome memories of adventures we three took together. Over the years, the love sisterhood that developed will be forever in my heart. As we grieve the loss of an amazing spirit, she would also like us to remember all the adventures and fun we shared together, from pushwalks, as Sharon called them, she sat, I pushed, and walked, to Berlin Raceway on Saturday nights, Fifth Third Ballpark, to our trip down south, and so many more. One memory was our trip to Brandon's wedding in Alabama. We went on a little detour to North Carolina to see our daughter Jessica and her family. She kept telling Jeff and I that when we get to the house, she was going to nap. Well, that all changed when she met Nancy, Jessica's mother-in-law. They started talking and didn't stop. They both were watching TV, kind of, to discover they both liked the same shows. We were all outside grilling dinner, and when we came back into the house, Sharon and Nancy were having a beer. Made Sharon start laughing about everything. We knew she shouldn't have had one. But it was too late to stop her. And you all know what happened when you tell Sharon no. That day she didn't care, and she was going to drink anyway. Needless to say, we all laughed so hard that night and had a blast. She slept most of the way to Alabama the next day and blamed Jeff for her headache. She was so thankful and happy to be at Brandon and Stephanie's wedding, seeing everyone dancing wheelchair style, singing and laughing. It was really hot that day and everyone was melting in the heat. Sharon was in shade but never complained about being warm. That's Sharon, always thankful. She wanted to see the ocean, so off we went, a big 12 miles away. We get her out onto the sand. Wheeling a wheelchair on sand is not easy, even if it is only 3 feet. She sat on a towel, I think, but she put her feet in the sand and laughed. Then she said to Jeff, "Put me in the water." I think that was the first time I ever heard no that fast out of Jeff's mouth when it came to Sharon. Before I can ever say anything, she was up and back in the chair. Sharon and I just smiled at each other. She just kept telling us, "Thank you for bringing her." Then on the way home, we went by Georgia to see my brother Jay and family. I remember her meeting my nephew, Isaac Naughton, and finding out that he was going to be on the Georgia Bulldogs football team. He hugged her, and she was blushing. Later, she told us that he was so handsome. Well, from that day on until now, Isaac had a fan. She told everyone she knew him. We truly did have so much fun on that trip together. Just one more memory that a lot of you shared with us. On one of our pushwalk days, Somehow we decided to go into town. It's about 2 miles, remember that. I never thought we would get halfway. Ha ha, but walking and talking go together, I guess. Because we were at N37, knowing Jeff was going to kill us. We crossed and went to the KC Lounge. And thirsty, we went in. We run into Marcia, these two together, oh boy, whispering and laughing all the time. We figured we'd eat. After chicken strips and fries, oops, I forgot about the wine coolers too. I realized we had no money. We had to call Jeff anyway. While he was fussing about it, Sharon, me, and half the lounge were laughing. Needless to say, he didn't stay too mad too long. With all the memories we shared together, I personally feel extra special that I could be the sister she never had. She told me a few days ago at the hospital, I felt so blessed. She had a kind heart, a godly spirit, contagious laugh, and a beautiful smile. Someone said the world had half the kindness that Sharon carries in her heart, it would be a much better place to live in. If you were lucky enough to know Sharon, you were blessed beyond words. Sharon will never forget the love and kindness you brought into our lives. We'll surely miss you, but now you can run in the fields, wildflowers free. Our adventures and memory of you will live in our hearts forever. Thank you for letting me be a part of that. In closing, may I share this quote for you. Grief never ends, but it changes. It's a passing, not a place to stay. Grief is not a sign of weakness, nor a lack of faith. It's the price of love. Thank you.
Very nice.
Thank you, Mary, even though you made me stand up here.
Very nice.
Thank you, Harriet and Laura Lee, for those words. And for all the times you took Sharon drinking. Okay. Oh, right.
Sorry, but she went once with us, too.
And you always go.
All right, now I invite Mary Ann Amlott to go for it.
Oh, my goodness. Well, gosh, I'm a wreck. But, I love Sharon very much. And my friend Lynn Flegel is the one and my son. And the night before, or two nights, I don't know exactly when, but I had prayed and I said, Lord, because finances were so bad, and I said, Lord, there must be something else I could do. I was working at the flower shop and just in on Madison Street and just making it. And my son called and he said, Mom, there's this job opportunity, and I'd done caretaking and that up in my hometown in Alpena, and took care of handicapped people, plus elderlies, and plus I was a waitress, so I was certainly used to waiting on people, and wiping butts, and a few other things.
What restaurant did you do that?
That was the boss. No. But anyway, so I took the job, and Sharon and I clicked right immediately, and I loved her smile, and I loved her spirit. And Jeff was, and them were going through a hard time at that time because their own mother was dying. So I stepped in and tried to help Jeff out as much as I could over at the house. So onward and upward. So I start taking care of Sharon, and there were good times, a lot of good times. There were bad times. We laughed, we cried, we yelled, we made up. Mostly there wasn't too much of that, though. It was mostly good times. But before I tell you the story, I want to tell you, I'm going to read this from Lynn. And my other son thought it might be best if I shut my phone off, so then I didn't realize it. I have so much trouble turning it back on. But anyway, this is from Lynn Flegel. Did anybody know Lynn here? Lynn Flegel, other than you guys, yeah. And, anyway, she goes back, and now this is what she has to say. She apologizes that she couldn't make it, but she's over in Bad Axe, and she's 80-some years old now. And so anyway, but this is what she had to say. I have known Sharon since about 1975. She participated in a class held in our church for the handicapped, and then in handbell choir that grew from the class. At first, Sharon was young enough to use crutches. Okay, I'm gonna catch up here. Okay, to use crutches, but it was difficult. Later, she used a wheelchair. I usually picked her up, so I knew how much she struggled, and I never heard her complain. I think of her as an extremely brave person in the way she dealt with her handicap. Later, when Sharon's mother was dying, I was able to help by finding you know who. Anyway, and her dedicated caregiving of many years, Mary Ann, who also became my good friend. The three of us, along with our mutual friend Brenda, went on many adventures. Sharon also had a great sense of humor, and we all know that. I will end by speaking unto Sharon, who is off on even better adventure. There goes my phone again. Go for it, girlfriend. So anyway, with that, yes, Sharon always called us girlfriend, brother, sisters. My kids over here and the grandkids, these two used to ride on the back of her wheelchair, you know, and they just thought it was so much fun, you know, and we'd all laugh and have a good time. And anyway, the one thing I want to tell you all is that Sharon had a love for God. Jesus was her boyfriend. And so anyway, we decided this one weekend we would take her up to Houghton Lake to the singles dance. Now, where else would all of single women want to go but to a singles dance? Yay! So anyway, we're going, we're having a great time, and we're all sitting around the table. Nobody's asking us to dance, which is always a good feeling. And somebody comes up and asks Sharon to dance. And I'm like, well, she's in a wheelchair? He said, great! So he took her out on the floor and he was whirling her. And I looked over at the girls and I said, well, I got my key for next time. I'm bringing a wheelchair. But anyway, so then he brings her back and he's knelt down now talking serious with her. And I hear her say, I have a boyfriend. I went, he's Jesus. Well, I want y'all to know right now that that is exactly where Sharon is. She is in heaven on her two feet and she is dancing with Jesus with the biggest smile that you'd ever want to see. And she loved us all. She loved everybody. So with that, I'm going to say thank you.
Thanks, Mom. And you navigated technology with that, too. That is really good. Sharon loved the song On Eagle's Wings. It's actually really quite popular at funerals, but it's good to sing at any time. So I invite you to join us, if you know it, in singing On Eagle's Wings.
Oh.
Save to the Lord my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under his wings your refuge, his faithfulness your shield, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall around you, he's given a command to guide you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, Sharon's boyfriend, so we're going to hear from his word. Sharon loved the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In a gospel reading from the book of Luke, the 15th chapter, this is called the parable of the lost son, or more popularly known as the prodigal son. And Jesus said, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided the property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.'" So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his fingers and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. John and Mary, Jeff and Laurie, family and friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. May he be present in your mourning, give you joy in your suffering, and give you hope that surpasses all understanding. So I haven't even introduced myself yet. I'm Jeff Amelot. I'm the Director of Youth and Family Ministry at Mamelon Lutheran Church. You already figured out that I'm Marianne's son, and we are connected to sharing through friendship and lots of love and laughter, like my mom said. And I'm honored to be here to officiate the celebration of a life well lived. So thank you all for being here to celebrate with us today. Toy NASCARs, both Matchbox and model size, lots of them. Jeff Gordon, Johnny Benson, Beanie Babies. Hundreds of Beanie Babies. Family. And no slight to anybody else, but especially cousin Bobby and nephew Brandon. Pets. Bobby the cat. Charlie the dog, Donnie and Marie, the colors purple and pink, Mamelon Lutheran Church, and Jesus. Those are the categories in the game What Sharon Loves. Or if you could put it in a shadow box, you probably couldn't fit all of that, or in some kind of display case. But the truth is, you all would be there too. Because Sharon loved all of you. And I don't know many of you, but I believe she loved all of you. Because that's who Sharon was, and that's what Sharon was about. All right, we're going to have a little time of interaction here. Okay, won't be much, just need your help. And Ma kind of already alluded to it, but Sharon had names for all of us, and they were all pretty similar, but you know, if you got this name, you were in, and it didn't take really much to be in, but all right. How many of you were ever called Buddy by Sharon? Raise your hand. Hey, Buddy? Yeah, all right. The one that I got called, and I know many of you guys were called, how about Brother? Hey, Brother! Come on, Randy, all right? Brother?
Especially with chicken nuggets when we walk through.
You got the chicken nuggets. Yeah. All right, that's enough interaction, okay?
I spoke for 10 people.
How about sister? Hey, sis or sister? Yeah, raise your hand. Yeah, yeah. You're probably the one that I laughed at the most. She never called me this, obviously, but, hey, girlfriend! There's lots of brothers, lots of buddies, lots of sisters, and lots of girlfriends here today. Well, guess what? You were all in, so congratulations. Didn't that feel good to be called that? Buddy, brother, sister, girlfriend. But life was not always easy for Sharon. Obviously, we all know that Sharon was born and lived her entire life with cerebral palsy. With that comes challenges and difficulties. Sharon was also the middle child of three in between two brothers, John and Jeff. And that could not have been easy either because, well, brothers, right? But Sharon lived an abundant life that was filled with an infectious joy. Sharon played the cards that life dealt her, but she did it with a smile on her face, always smiling. Now, as a child, Sharon had some adventures. Jeff shared with me a couple stories about pushing her down to the Pikes, who lived on the corner of Peach Ridge. Sharon loved to see the cows. And I think Jeff was instructed to take her up to the fence. Jeff doesn't follow instructions. So he liked to push her into the field right where the cows were, and Sharon laughing the whole time, enjoying it, because Sharon loved animals too. And I could just see her being right there with those cows. But Jeff said, one time that cow licked her so hard, I thought she was going to come right out of her chair. Oh, Sharon, I could just see that smile on her face. And naughty younger brother Jeff, again, spent a lot of time with her, growing up in the house with her. When Jeff was at driving age, and Sharon spent a lot of time with John as well, but Jeff had a fast car. And Jeff took Sharon places, and Sharon liked to go places with her. He took her to places she wasn't supposed to go, though, like the party their parents didn't know about. And he drove a little faster than he was probably supposed to drive, like driving 90 on the back roads to get to that party. Because you were running late. Must be a Jeff thing, huh, Jeff?
No, it's a little certain.
It could be that, too. But Sharon laughed the whole way on those back roads, driving 90. So Brandon got his love for speed from Sharon. I think Sharon got it driving 90 in the back seat of Jeff's car. Either way, you guys are all hot rods on two wheels, man. I'll tell you what. And Sharon had an attitude of gratitude. If you knew her, you knew she appreciated everything. If you knew her, you would hear her say thank you, right? How many times could one person say thank you? Well, Sharon was filled with gratitude. She appreciated everyone and everything. Mary reminded me how much she loved to go to work. She was excited when that Hope Network bus would pull up to the house to take her off to work. She worked sorting parts. Like, who would love doing that? Sharon loved doing that, because Sharon loved to be out with people. And there were other folks in wheelchairs, and she loved every one of them. She appreciated being out of the house. She appreciated wherever she was. How many of us can say that? How many of us can say that? And how about go with the flow? Anybody ever heard Sharon say that? I just go with the flow. Oh my goodness. Some of us need to learn some lessons from Sharon to go with the flow. One of my favorite go with the flow stories was with Mom and Sharon. Mom looked at the clock and she thought she was late getting Sharon ready. She had to get Sharon ready for work. So she got Sharon up out of bed. And they could whip around pretty fast for a couple of old ladies, huh? And she got her in the shower and looking good and dressed and ready to go. And she got her up to the table eating. And that bus is going to be here any minute. And she thinks we got her ready to go. And my mom looked at the clock. She misread it. She was 2 hours early. More than that. 3 hours early. She was early. Sun wasn't up yet. That should have been here first. But they laughed, so Ma said, all right, Sharon, you can go back to bed. She said, don't move. Your hair looks good. You're dressed. Don't move. Sharon said, I just go with the flow. Just go with the flow. Like when Mom tried to drive her to the movie theater.
Oh, no.
in that old van. Everybody remember that old van of Sharon's in the elevator? Oh, Lord, have mercy. That thing should have been retired long before it was. And I don't know if my mom should have ever been allowed to drive it, but they both survived. Well, there they were at the movie theater, and she was lowering the elevator to the ramp on the concrete. There was a spot for that. And she missed. And was like, here. So she couldn't get it down or else Sharon would have fallen out. So she, rather than pull Sharon back, Sharon's out on the hangar going down. Rather than pull Sharon back in, she went forward while Sharon's out there on the hangar laughing and smiling. My sister Debbie, who couldn't be here today, is going, Ma, what are you doing? You're going to get arrested. So she went too far, lowered it. Nope, that's not good. Had to back up. We're like, oh.
Three times.
And here's Sharon just smiling. I just go with the flow. Well, luckily, Mom wasn't arrested, so.
Oh, and then the rest of that story was then. So then when I finally was able to get her off.
Get her off.
And we're running up the.
Pay for tickets and get to the movies.
Yeah. Then those legs.
The wheels
fell off. The wheelchair legs fell off.
Wheelchair legs fell right off. And then they were right in the middle of Star Theater on Alpine trying to pick up the pieces. That was an adventurous night.
There are social workers here.
There are social workers here. Are you looking for a job, Mom? Because you're not going to find it. When they ran out of propane and it was in the middle of winter, and Sharon, obviously it was cold in the house, and they were all bundled up, and Ma decided to open up the oven door and put Sharon's feet were all in stockings and mittens, and she was all bundled up, and Ma put her feet right up on the door of that oven, and Mr. Bowman, who was the executor for a time of the estate, comes in and looks, knowing that they were out of propane to heat the house. He said, Sharon, is that, are you staying warm? Oh, yeah. Is that oven helping him? Is that keeping you warm? Yeah. He says, I'm not sure how, because that's a gas stove. But, okay.
Going with the flow.
Sharon would just go with the flow. And again, always saying thank you. It didn't matter what. I mean, people would come up to communion at church, and the body and blood of Christ given and shed for you. If anybody said anything, it was often amen. Every time, and I put a big smile on my face, Sharon would say, thank you! That's probably a better response. We should all say thank you when we receive communion. Thank you! Now, not to say that Sharon wouldn't get mad or upset. I've seen her upset. That's just human. She's not Jesus. It's her boyfriend, but she's not Jesus. She'd get mad, and Jeff reminded me that when she was walking on crutches, that she would definitely, if her brothers were within reach, she could whack them pretty good in the back of the head when they made them mad. So, not perfect, but human, but still full of love and joy. In fact, I think Sharon, like I said, is a great example for all of us, a shining example. Not just go with the flow, but an example of joy, of love, of kindness, of generosity. I mean, she loved her church, our church, Mammon Lutheran Church. She gave her money there, but also gave extra. I've been in charge of youth and family ministry for a number of years, and she would always come to a fundraiser that we had to support the kids, and she would always give. She would always give, and I would appreciate that, knowing that she gave out of joy and the abundance of her heart, because she wanted the kids to be supported in mission work and in whatever trips that we were taking. So yes, Sharon was an example for all of us. And as I think about today's gospel, Laura Lee told me she loved that story. The prodigal son, again, the story of redemption. The son leaves his father and goes and blows everything on wild living, and he comes crawling back with his tail tucked between his legs, not knowing what his dad would say, and his father lovingly took him back. It's a great story of forgiveness and of grace and of love, and we all relate ourselves when we hear that story of the son who went away but was welcomed back in. Sharon said that she was amazed at how God loves us and will always welcome us back, forgive us, and redeem us. Sharon knew that she was a redeemed and loved child of God. That's why Jesus was her boyfriend. And I believe that's where her joy came from. I want to give you a little bit of insight about that story in Luke 15. Again, it is about forgiveness and redemption, but there's some behind the scenes that Jesus spoke this parable, and he used his words very specifically to his audience, and they knew what he meant. See, at that time and in that culture, if a son were to ask his father for an inheritance, it would basically be him saying, "I wish my father were dead," because sons didn't do that. They stayed with the family. That was the family business. They stayed together. That was the culture they lived in. So when the son asked, "Give me my share," the people listening to this story would have interpreted saying, "This son wants his father dead. Wow. That's big time right there. That's you don't do that." So that's an important piece of this story and why the son was so humbled when he came back, because no son would do that to his father. And when the son went away and lost everything and came to the conclusion that his father's servants had it better than him, it was an act of almost humiliation for him to go back, but he had nothing else that he could do. He had to go back, and that's why he thought in his head, "I'm not worthy to be called son, but if my father would take me back as a servant, it would be better than this." So he had this plan in his head to go back, even though he brought great shame upon his father by asking for the inheritance, by saying, "Father, I would rather you be dead so I can get what I have coming to me." He knew he brought shame upon his father, but he came back hoping that his father would at least welcome him as a servant. Because a father, if that were to happen, would probably have not taken a son back, because it would have hurt so much, and he would have said, "This son is dead to me now." And that's how the culture would have responded. But rather than do that, this father kept looking and waiting. And when the son, who had his tail between his legs, was walking back, the father saw him in the distance, because he was a loving father, longing for his son to come back. He was looking, searching for his lost son every day. And when he saw him, the father did something very undignified. Again, it would be undignified even to welcome the son back who did that. But even more so, he did something that no dignified father would ever do. He ran to his son because he was overfilled with joy about welcoming his son back in. Now, running itself was undignified, because they wore those robes, and fathers would not run. They would walk stately. They would not do anything that would be embarrassing, but only remain dignified. Well, this father hiked up his robe, and he ran to his son because he loved his son and would do anything for him to welcome him back, to give him grace, to show him mercy, to show him love. And Jesus told this parable because he wanted to share with the people what the Father's heart was all about, how deep and how wide the Father's love was for his son, and even more so, how deep and wide the Father's love is for all of us. Now, as I think of Sharon, yes, she knew she was redeemed and forgiven and loved, but I really think Sharon reminds me more of the Father in this story. Because Sharon is always loving, Sharon is always forgiving, and Sharon is always welcoming. She has the heart of the father who never gave up on his beloved son. And I don't think Sharon has ever given up on anyone. And Sharon has certainly never stopped loving any of us. And I believe in my heart of hearts, from knowing Sharon, that that's what Sharon would want us to know too. That Sharon would want us to know how loved we are, that we all, every one of us here, are redeemed and loved children of God. The Apostle Paul says in Romans 8, chapter 38 and 39, he says, "For I am convinced," he says, "I am convinced, I am convicted in my heart of hearts, beyond a shadow of a doubt, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither things in the present nor things in the future, not a power on earth, neither height nor depth nor anything else will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." And I believe that Sharon lived that love. Now, maybe you've been a part of a church your whole life. Maybe it's been a while. Maybe you've never been a part of the church. we can easily miss this message, even though we saw it in Sharon in all our interactions with her. We can easily miss this if we just keep our eyes on the struggle. If we only focus on the negative that's around us. But that's not what Sharon did. That's not what Sharon did, not what she was about. We could miss that truth that we are loved, forgiven, and redeemed. But why don't we be a little more like Sharon today? So I guess I challenge us all to be like Sharon, to accept and receive the love of Jesus, which makes all the difference in the world. Again, look how Sharon lived her life. And I'll repeat what Laura Lee said in her tribute. If half the people in the world had the kindness and love that Sharon had, then we wouldn't have half the problems. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One minute.
Thank you.
Thank you. I thought you were like, all right, you done? Almost. But thank you for saying thank you.
Remember long-winded we talked about?
Yeah, we already went past that. I added some stories, sorry. Sharon was an angel on earth sent to remind us of how precious life is. Let me read that again. Sharon was an angel on earth sent to remind us how precious life is. And now that earth angel is dancing and running on strong legs through pink and purple flowers with her boyfriend Jesus. So, all you brothers and buddies, all you sisters and girlfriends, may we be like Sharon. May we turn our eyes upon Jesus, and may we receive, like Sharon did, his love, his grace, his redemption for our lives. And then, may we smile big enough to fill a room and spread that love and joy of Jesus all around us, just like Sharon did. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sharon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Sharon, my mom reminded me that Sharon loved the Lord's Prayer, and I'm honored to be asked to sing that for you today. So this will be our sermon prayer today. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Sharon, you're welcome. Before we have a sending commendation prayer, I just want to invite everybody for a luncheon in Sharon's honor and on behalf of the Lesser family. It'll be at Mamaroneck Lutheran Church in the Community Center. That's out on, it's on Lutheran Church Road, but really it's corner of Fruit Ridge and Lutheran Church Road between 14 and 15 miles. Oh, the map is in the back. It's out to the west here. Please join us for a time of celebration and lunch. And now, would you stand as you are able, please? Let us pray. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Sharon. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. And now may you receive the benediction. May the Lord always bless you and keep you. May he let his face shine upon you. May the Lord always walk beside you. May the Lord always bless you and keep you. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Family and friends, you can have a seat this time. This does conclude our services for Sharon at the funeral home. On behalf of the immediate family, we want to thank everyone. Compared to Pastor, and I can't sing like him.
I'm closer to the mic, though.
This does conclude our services at the funeral home for Sharon. On behalf of the immediate family, we do want to thank everyone for being here today and for your prayers and continued support throughout this time. So if you could, please just stay in your seats. Rod, starting in the back of the chapel, he's going to dismiss each row individually. So when your row is dismissed, you're welcome to come forward if you wish, pay your final respects. There are maps with directions to the luncheon over by the guest book, so if you haven't signed that, you can sign that on your way out. And again, everyone's invited to the luncheon immediately after. We're going to give immediate family just a little alone time to say their final goodbyes too. So, Pastor is going to have prayer now for the luncheon.
Yeah, to avoid that awkward, do I go first? Do we need to wait for a prayer while we get to the luncheon? So, we'll pray now, and then please help yourselves as you get there and enjoy a time of fellowship. So, Lord Jesus, you were at the wedding feast at Cana, and you performed miracles, and we know that Sharon is feasting with you at the great banquet in heaven, and you've given her the best miracle of all, eternal life. We ask your blessing now upon us who remain, that we would celebrate her life well in memories and in laughter and even in our tears. We still get to feast here, so we ask your blessing upon the food, upon the fellowship, upon the memories, and upon all the friends gathered. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, brother.
Thank you, buddy.